Everybody, welcome to Caketastic Cakes. It's Jen, and I'm going to show you today how I made this Squid Game cake and all the decorations you see with it. And each of those decorations are representing one of the six challenges that they went through, as well as some edible fake blood to go with it, because, yeah, Squid Game, blood. Okay, to begin, I'm going to cover my cake plate. I've got just a regular old silver scalloped cake plate there, a cardboard cake plate. I'm rolling out some black fondant. I'm going to roll it nice and thin, and then I'm going to lay it over top of my cake plate. And I'm going to try to lay it over without getting any air bubbles in it. Then I'm just pressing down along the scalloped edge because I didn't have any round plates or square plates. I only had scalloped left. So yes, this is what I got. So the fondant is folded over the sides and it goes tucked into the edges. And then I trimmed off underneath the plate with a knife to get rid of the extra. Now I've rolled out more blue fondant. It's actually kind of like a mixture of teal and blue. I think it should have been a little more green. I think I took too much out when I added the royal blue. But I folded over my cake and I'm just trimming off the extra, smooth down the sides, just like you would cover your cake in fondant. And then carefully transfer it onto your cake plate. I have it a little off center, kind of a lot off center, because I'm going to add decorations in front of it and I want to give it some room. This white that I'm using my pizza cutter there that I used to trim my cake as well, I'm rolling out just a nice long rectangle of fondant, white fondant, rolled pretty thin, pretty darn thin actually. And these are going to become the stripes on either side of the cake. You're going to see I'm going to put one right there. And then the other one on the other side of the cake. This is supposed to represent the tracksuit that they all wore and the white stripes that they have down the shoulders and top of their sleeves. I have a real skinny little rectangle here that I cut out. Also, again, very thin, that I'm using the jaggedy edge of my fondant rolling ribboning tool. I don't know what it's called. And it makes a little zigzag pattern right down the center of it. I'm going to put that in the middle of my two stripes on the front there. Trim off the extra again. And that is representing now the zipper on the front of the tracksuit, assuming it will stick. So, yes, sometimes you have to put them back on a little bit because they just don't want to stick. Just smoothing out little wrinkles, some little marks I made. And we're going to have a little bit of a time jump right there. Okay, so that's some more of the same teal fondant right there. And some more, actually, this is white gum paste. So the teal, the little blue patch that you see there is just a thin rectangle I cut out of the fondant. And now I'm cutting out the numbers. I'm just freehand styling a 4, a 5, and a 6 out of gum paste. I'm using gum paste because when you start carving little things like this, when you lift them up, they can pull and then they stretch and distort and you have to start over or it just doesn't come out as good and it makes me crazy. So yes, that's why I'm doing half fondant, half gum paste with this one. So again, I'm just going with the numbers of the main character. I think his name was Gion. And there you go. Just try to make them all the same size. If you have number print, you know, little print set or something, you're going to come out with much better looking numbers than me. Just make sure you make them nice and big so that they fill your rectangle. And your rectangle needs to be nice and big to fill up a good amount of the one side of the cake. Just like that. There you go. Just carefully pressing it on. Ooh, a little different angle there, right? What am I doing? Wanted to show you how now I at the side I rolled out some more of the fondant. Nice and long using my fondant spreading tool there. And I'm going to wrap it around the entire number, the whole rectangle there. Because in the movie, the patches all have like kind of like a trim around them, a little decorative trim maybe? I don't know, just the edge of patches, how they have that little lip. And once it's all tucked up nice and tight, then we are going to be done with the cake and start with the decorations. Now, I am going to start with the honeycomb challenge first. I have some just gray gum paste. I'm using all gum paste now for these decorations. I rolled it between my hands to kind of make a tapered, you know, long needle is what I'm making here. So I've got it real sharp and pointy on one end. It flares bigger on the other end. As you can see, I'm just pressing down a tiny little bit on the big end. And I'm using my very sharp, very small little veining tool there to poke a hole in it and just wiggling it back and forth to make the eye of the needle. I've got a little lump there that I just trimmed off. And that's it. That's it. It's done. So I'm just going to put it aside on a paper towel and let it dry. We will come back to it though, so don't get too forgetful about it. Here is just some yellow gum paste. It's actually gold gum paste that I've got. I just gently pressed a star that I have in there and made a little line coming down from it. I didn't press all the way through, though. I just kind of made a print is all I did. I trimmed the circle out of it right there. I've got some gold shimmer here. I was just trying to make it look, I don't know, a little more sugary, I guess, sugar wafery. And I pressed it with a paper towel to make it look a little rougher, a little more bumpy, but it lost its shape, so now I'm retrimming it. I'm just rubbing a little bit of that gold shimmer that I had on my fingers because I made a big mess of it, that I edited out so you didn't see, you know, any imperfections on my end. Put that aside, let it dry. Now I'm going to make the marble. I can't make glass marbles out of gum paste, or clear, you know, out of gum paste, so I went with white. I just have three colors here. I have some green, some red, and some blue that I broke into little pieces, as you can see, just kind of twisted them together. I have my white gum paste right there. I'm just going to wrap it around and then just roll it into a ball. I'm pressing really hard between my hands, and that will get rid of any creases or cracks in the gum paste. But then I end up with this, yeah, it looks almost like a gumball, a ball rather than a marble, but we'll just use our imaginations there. I suppose if you have an isomalt mold, you could do it that way. That would be cool, but I do not. So this is what I did. This shape here is going to be my knife blade. I didn't think of a way to put the squid, the shape of the squid for the last challenge on my cake. So I figured the knife was pretty symbolic of it anyway, so it was okay. The knife blade shape itself is rather unique. It's more, you know, like I said, like you can see here, kind of angled. It's straight and then angles and then swoops around back toward the base. It's got a thick piece of metal that comes out the bottom that would connect it to the handle. So that's what that little rectangle is. And this is just some white and some of the gold gum paste. And as you can see, I'm rolling it between my hands. I kind of rolled it together. And I'm pressing it out. I didn't like how it looked. It didn't look, you know, weathered or not weathered, just kind of grained enough. So I'm twisting it up and rolling it out in between my hands again. I was like, oh yeah, okay, I like how this looks. That just happened to work. So I'm going with it. And yeah, so I trimmed off the one edge. It is thicker than the blade, of course, but a little bit thinner than that piece of metal sitting on top of the blade, or piece of gray sitting on top of the blade. I'm just trimming down the handle a little bit. I put two indentations using the back of my veining blade or my veining tool there and put two little balls of the silver or the gray gum paste in there as well, because it was hard for me to see the knife when I was trying to look at it, but it looked like it had some kind of like little bolts holding the blade through the handle. So that's what I was trying to do. I'm pressing down on the edge of the blade with the back of my paintbrush there to give it the serrated edge. I put a couple little indentations to make it, I guess, more switchblady looking, more threatening looking. And I'm not connecting them. There's no need for me to connect them because they're going to just lay on the cake, so I wasn't worried about that. I sprayed it with some edible silver shimmer, put that aside, and let it dry. All right. I know these challenges are a bit out of order, but that's okay. All right, now we've got the tug of war challenge here. I've got some white gum paste, rolled it out nice and long and folded it in half. Pick off any of the little colors that stuck from the other decorations I was working on. And then I started twisting, and I twisted and I twisted and I twisted it nice and tight. And of course, as I twisted it nice and tight, it became more and more stretched out and it became longer. So I'm just going to keep going until I have the whole thing twisted. And I'm going to try to make it as even as I can too. It is definitely not perfect because when you get, well, for me, when I do these long pieces like this that I twist, I am not the most even twister in the world here in the cake decorating universe. So I'm rolling it a little bit with my fondant paddle just to kind of smooth out the big rough edges. Speaking of rough edges, I am now taking the one end and kind of chopping it up and roughing it up with my knife. This is to kind of demonstrate the one end that gets cut by the guillotine when the team loses. I'm going to take a little piece of red here. I rolled it out pretty darn thin. I tapered the two edges, as you can see, and I'm just folding it over. And there you go. Got a flag in the center. Okay, here's another thing where I was not sure what to do with it. So I went with the little chess pieces that they use to mark the people in the bridge challenge. Again, I can't make clear out of gum paste, so I'm choosing to use white. If you have some kind of chess piece molds that you could do an isomalt in, that would be amazing. And then you could just paint the numbers on. But this is what I did. This is how I did it. I've got just a white gum paste square there. And this is going to be my horse's head. I'm pressing down at the bottom into the counter, and I had pressed between my hands like that, as you saw when I used my fingers too, to kind of separate a section, make a thin section between the head and the base. I pulled out a little bit of a muzzle there. I cut the little section out between the ears at the top to separate the horse's ears. Try to shape them a little bit nicer because they're a little rough. I gotta say, this one was tough. This one did not come out as a shining star. But it gets the job done, right? So it's not so terrible. Again, I'm just using my paintbrush handle, whatever I got, to put them together. I have some of this kind. It's a rose color, actually, I think it's called. And it comes out kind of like a deep hot pink, in my opinion, which worked well, again, with the cake and everything. So I just carved the number 11 because why not? It's a nice, easy number to make. And there was 16, I think, of them. All right, speaking of that hot pink, I'm going to now cut some strips out in order to make the cake plate more like the boxes that you saw throughout the whole series. So I've just got a nice rectangle here, and I'm going to make a thicker rectangle once again. And I don't need a lot of rectangle because the cake covers a lot of the cake plate. I'm folding the thicker one, though, in half, so it is a little longer. And then I'm just pinching into the center, just carefully pinching into the center. Press gently in the center of either side toward the center, and you have a bow shape. It's that easy. Yeah, it's not tough at all. I've got another little strip that I'm going to cover the middle with. It was a little too fat, so I trimmed it. Going to wrap it around just like that. There you go. Bow. Easy, right? No problem. Okay, so now I'm just putting on the pieces of the rectangle that I cut, just trimming off the extras. I have it lined up. I did one going toward the front and the two sides. If you want to do one in the back too, go right ahead. No one was seeing the back of my cake, so I didn't care. However, that is probably a bad attitude to have. But anyway, that's what I did. Put my little bow right in the front, and now you got that little gift box with a card in it. Yes, I'm wrapping my rope, my little tug-of-war rope around it on the sides there. And now I am going back to my needle. I am spraying it with the same silver shimmer that I used before. And with the wafer and the marble, I'm spraying it with an edible glaze. So this will make it shiny, like really, really shiny. It's actually really cool and I like it a lot. I just don't get a lot of chances to use it. All right, so this now is going to be the last decoration I show you. And it's kind of the roughest one. I tried here, okay? So maybe you can see what I did and make it better. It'll at least maybe give you a good foundation, right? That's my hope anyway. I have that metal thing that I covered with a paper towel. It goes into the center of my really large cake baking pans. It just helps cakes bake evenly. When they're so big, the center would still be mush otherwise. So I just pressed down some kind of beige colored gum paste over it that I had to shape pretty much like a ball. It came out a little pudgier at the bottom and a little narrower at the top, which I felt like was okay. I used my fingers to press in kind of where the eyes are going to go, and I'm tucking in where the chin was going to go too. So on either side of the chin, actually. I'm using the large ball there on that tool in order to create a couple of hollows for the doll's eyes. This is going to be the doll head for the red light, green light. Yes, that one. I tried. Again, I tried. So, you know, be kind here. I'm using a knife blade to just cut open a little bit for a mouth because her mouth is kind of open. I'm using a small tool just to open a little bit more there. Okay, and now I'm going to start adding some hair. I kind of jump around a little bit with this, so just bear with me. I'm going to start with her bangs and I guess the front of her hair. I just rolled out the black a little bit thicker. It's not too thin. Kind of just covered it over her head. I'm going to trim off those sides, kind of fold them back a little bit. And that's it. Like, I probably should have done more. The head shape should have been rounder, like all these shoulda, woulda, couldas, you know. But at the time, I was like trying to get it to work. But yeah, so I put some grooves in it to show where the lines in her bangs are. Because if you look at her in the show, you can see like little indentations. I'm filling up the eye sockets with some white gum paste. I'm trying to really keep more of an angle in the corners. And trying to keep it flat along the bottom of the eye and then a nice curve over the top like a rainbow eye, basically. Because the way the doll's eyes are kind of tricky for me. I should have put a little more time into them, but I didn't. I was trying to get this done. All right, I put a couple indentations with my big ball tool there that I filled with brown gum paste. And now I'm pressing a little bit of black gum paste on top of those to make the pupils and the irises of the eyes. I'm going to add the eyelids now because their eyes are kind of closed a little bit. And I rolled out some of that same beige color again between my fingers so it was tapered at either end and a little bit thicker in the center. I'm trying to connect it down into the corner of either side of the eye. Same thing, you can kind of see the shape there. I'm using my small ball on there to just press it oh so carefully into place. Trying to keep it smooth, trying not to lose the nice curve of it or anything. Now I'm going to give her her eyelashes. I did the same thing with some black, just rolled it really thinner. And again, having it a little bit more tapered at either end. Trying to get it down in the corner, trying to make sure in either corner, trying to make sure I don't lose the shape. And it's not bad. Like, it's not terrible. But yeah, okay. Now I've got two balls of gum paste there that I'm rolling between my fingers. And those are going to become her ears. Her ears are, unfortunately, more complicated than not. So I pressed them kind of into an elongated C, like up and down C. I'm tucking in the one outside edge where it's thicker because the one side is thinner because the C kind of curves, you know. And they curve toward each other. I pressed on the top and bottom inside the ear to try to separate. I have no idea what the anatomy of the ear is called. So you got that little bridge that goes kind of across the center. Trying to make that. And then with a little bit of water, I stick them onto her head and just press down in the front carefully, trying not to mess them up. All right, now her nose. I start with a little triangle of gum paste. It's like a pyramid you cut in half, I guess you could say. But it's pretty small. It's not too big. She doesn't have a very big nose at all. It is very triangular in shape, where it's longer at the top, of course. And I rounded it off because as I'm pressing it into place, I know I'm going to make it wider. So I'm using my ball tool, the big part, to try to kind of rub the edges in, the small ball tool, pressing into her nostril, two indentations for her nostrils, and then tucking the gum paste up and into her nostrils where it comes down. Okay, so it kind of becomes actual nostrils. I'm dipping the small ball tool there into a little bit of water. And then I'm rubbing along the seam of her nose on either side. This was helping to blend it in so it didn't look totally like I had plopped a nose on her face and attached it. It just blended in a bit more so it looked a little nicer, a little cleaner. Now this is going to be the back of her head. I'm kind of making a mustache or a bow tie shape. See that? I have the one shape that I just freehanded. I'm putting it on the back of her head and then tracing out along the top of her hair there that I have already. Trim off the extra, put it back on, because she has the big part of her hair in the front is the bangs, and in the back it separates into the two little pigtails. And again, because it's just a severed head, it's not going to have the pigtails sitting quite properly. I'm going to do a little creative license with it. So I trimmed off the extra, I tucked it under the bangs in the back there, and just smoothed it out like I could, as best I could. I made two large circles. Again, it's pretty thick. I took a nip out of each one, and then I pinched down on the top, and these are going to become her pigtails. I'm putting two indentations on both of them, as you can see, to make lines for her hair. Now I'm trimming off a flat edge on either side where it's going to connect, and I pressed a piece of spaghetti into either side of her head behind her ear. This is dry spaghetti. I use it in place of toothpicks because when I make cakes, I don't want anybody getting hurt. And no kid is ever going to get hurt on one of my cakes. They might eat some dry spaghetti and not taste very good, but no one's getting stabbed. Okay, so I just slid the hair onto the spaghetti sticks with a little bit of water, and there they go. So she's not the best, but she's not terrible either. I've got some of the rose color that I mixed a little bit of rose color with some extra beige that I had to make her lips, because she definitely has very pink and noticeable lips. I shaped the bottom one just kind of like, you know, a little fat in the center and thin on each side. And the top lip definitely has a little cupid bow thing going with it. But you don't want to give her sexy, sultry lips. You want her to still have, you know, just little doll lips. Again, I tried. I'm going to keep saying this, but I did. I tried. All right, now I'm making the hair clip that she wears on her hair. I had a heck of a time trying to figure out what the symbols were. I'm assuming it's the circle, triangle, square. I'm not positive. So if I'm wrong, forgive me. Make it a proper shape. So I just rolled out some purple, nice and thin. I cut out a circle. I cut out a second circle and sliced that one in half. And that one I'm trying to put on the front more like the triangle. I should have gone sharper with the edges. And that one is more like the square in the back. Kind of looks like three circles. I should have been more careful with my edges there, but that's what I tried to do. These are for her pigtail holders. I just rolled out some purple, put some indentations in it, wrapped it around because her pigtail holders are kind of like a bunch of beads. So I, again, just put some indentations in it, wrap it around, and then I use the handle of my paintbrush there to just kind of tuck in along those indentations just to make it look a little more separated. But there you go. All right. And I know she doesn't really have clear eyebrows, but I felt like she needed something because she's kind of creepy, this thing that I made. Not quite as cute as the one in the movie or in this series. So I drew on a couple little thin eyebrows. All right. One last final touch. I know that was our last decoration, but this is a final touch, so it doesn't count as a decoration. I'm making some fake blood. This is the recipe I came up with that works for me. I add a half a teaspoon of cocoa powder to 3 tablespoons of corn syrup, stir it in together, add a big old dollop of some red gel food coloring, and you get some beautiful fake blood. I don't add any water to mine. I don't want it to be so runny. If you feel like it's too thick, add a tiny amount, like maybe a quarter of a teaspoon, half teaspoon of water to it. See how it looks. I didn't want it too runny, and I wanted it darker and richer because going on the teal that I've got there, that blue cake, it would very easily end up looking brown, just brown and not red. Like, I wanted a dark, rich red. I didn't want that light-colored red that a lot of fake blood looks like, and eh, you know. So, I was happy with it. I drizzled it all over, as you see. Plop my decorations on, or I mean carefully place my decorations on my cake with my crazy-looking head front and center there. Add a little bit more blood to my knife. Have it dripping on my decorations a little bit. Of course, she needs a little bit on her cheek because, yeah, that's what the pictures all look like. And, yeah, there you go. You've got a very, very fun, very busy Squid Game cake with every single challenge represented. And some blood because, yeah, blood. So I hope you found this video helpful. Please like and subscribe because it helps me out too. I've got a lot of other videos out there, so please take a look. And as always, thank you for watching Caketastic Cakes.